Livingston Family Dentistry knows the value of a healthy, beautiful smile. With over 30 years of experience, Dr. Ronald and Dr. Blake Livingston and their friendly staff are committed to making you feel comfortable, informed, and satisfied. So whether it's routine dentistry, cosmetic improvement, or complete restoration, bring your smile back to life at Livingston Family Dentistry, located at 13724 Woodward in Highland Park. Call now, 313-883-3050. If your teeth are not becoming to you, then you should be coming to us.
Good morning, and welcome to the Brenda Perryman Show right here on TV 33, WHPR, Comcast 90 and 91, and all over the world, courtesy of the World Wide Web. Excuse me. I have a wonderful show for you this morning, something that I believe everyone can benefit from. My two guests are just extraordinary. And then I want to remind you that we have Table Talk right after the show, and we have some good topics that we're going to talk about on Table Talk. And I'd like you to chime in, because one of them has to do with violence and some other things and national issues. And we really need to talk at this table today. So my second guest is Dr. Bridget Leonard, who is the president of Black Nurses Rock, which is a national organization, and she's the president of the Detroit chapter. And my first guest is the president and CEO of the Michigan Women's Foundation, Carolyn Casson. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you so much for having me.
Oh, I'm so glad you're here. You know, we hear about the Michigan Women's Foundation because you're everywhere. You're not just here in the area.
No.
You're around the state, right?
We are a statewide organization.
Why don't you tell my audience a little about it?
The Michigan Women's Foundation has been around for a long time. Those of us who have a few years may remember it from more than 30 years ago now. We've been fighting to create justice for women. And now our efforts have shifted a little bit to try to actually transform Michigan so this can be the best place in the United States for young women and for girls and for women of any age to actually transform their lives and make sure that they have they're on equal footing with the rest of this with everyone else in this country.
And what affects girls and women really affect
all of us.
You know, we see the strength, and we see that as far as we've come along, there's still a ways to go.
You know, that's what surprises me. I don't know about you, but I thought we'd be done by now.
I thought
this was such a obvious thing. You know, it was a movement that kind of arose out of the 60s and 70s and 80s, and I just thought that it was so obvious that women are just as good as men in anything that they say and do. And in some places, I think we do a better job in some ways. But we certainly can do a different job, and we should be recognized for that. But
and women look at things. Women look at things differently. I was just telling some people this morning that Hillary Clinton's emails wouldn't have meant a thing if she were a man.
Right. We'd have been long past that. But, you know, I really think that it's a surprise to me. I don't think young girls really realize all the things that we went through to get to where we are, but we haven't made that next leap, which is really to, you know, kind of an equal playing field.
You know, it's interesting. I directed a play about the Sweet Trial. It was a historic trial here in Detroit in 1925 or 26, really, and the jury was an all-white jury mm-hmm. of men. Women could not even sit
on a jury. Right. Yeah, so a lot has changed.
Yes.
A lot of very good things have happened. We like to focus on the good.
Well, let's first kind of talk about your journey to the Michigan Women's Foundation.
Well, my journey, my personal journey, you know, in some ways has been leading me to this point all my life. I feel as if I started out as an entrepreneur myself.
Really?
Started a hospice organization back in the early 1980s.
In the 80s,
when people thought it was a sort of an interesting idea, but there was no money in it, wanted to really change the world. I'm a child of the 60s, and so I thought the world should be a better place because I lived in it somehow, in some small way. And so I set out to help transform how dying took place in this country. And so stayed with the hospice movement for 30 years, built 4 companies, sold the last one in 2009, and came back home where I got my start.
So
right
where
here
were
in Michigan.
You?
I was here. At first, I was in Battle Creek, Michigan.
Okay.
Then I was in Detroit. I started the Hospice of Michigan. I put 17 hospices together, and we created, I think, the best and certainly the most sophisticated hospice program in the United States. And then I took that national, and we started a company that went public in 2005, and it's, you know, very exciting. So I came back to my hometown of Detroit, where I learned everything.
So you were from here originally?
I wasn't born here,
okay.
But I spent all my professional life here,
okay.
And brought up my children here. So okay. This is my home.
Right.
This is my home. And so when that career was over, because, you know, once you sell the company, people don't always want you around. I decided that I needed to take all of that experience, as you and I were talking.
Well, did you have a background in medical or anything when you went into that?
I was an administrator by training.
Okay.
I had a master's degree in public administration.
Okay.
So
I was an administrator.
I like to run things.
Oh, okay.
So that was really my interest, was in trying to figure out how you could scale this, how you could bring this to more people, not just, you know, where you could put a group of great nurses together, great social workers, great doctors, but how you could do this across a whole state, how you could do this across a whole nation.
So in 2009,
I came back home, and the Michigan Women's Foundation was looking around for a leader, and my dear, dear friend Linda Forte, who some of your listeners may know well, came to me and said, you know, you should think about this. You should do this. I think this is where you're meant to be. And so I listened to my heart. I listened to my friend, Linda, and I came aboard. We were a struggling little organization then. We were looking for what we could do to help Detroit and help the state of Michigan, which was in real economic trouble then.
Yes, I think all of us are aware
of that. And so everything we do today is really built around kind of what was happening there in 2008, 2009, 2010. And we decided to kind of focus on 3 important things that nobody else was doing. And one was, how do we revitalize our economy for women? Women have always been the backbone of every economy in the world.
Right.
And, you know, you invest in a woman and you get multiplier effect. You get, because a woman helps support her family, she helps support the community. And so we decided to start investing in women entrepreneurs. And we decided that that would be a good thing to do. We piloted it here in Detroit for the first couple of years.
Oh, you did?
We did. We started a microloan program for women entrepreneurs. We've made loans to 76 women entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
It has been the most exciting experience of my life. It pales in comparison to death and dying, I'm telling you.
I know it does.
It's wonderful.
Well, I have 3 key initiatives that you have: the
entrepreneurship,
developing the next generation of women leaders,
young women leaders,
and advancing Michigan's woman's agenda.
And we started out to really focus that. That was a broad category. It could be anything, right?
Right.
What is on women's agenda right now? We decided 2 years ago that the most important thing we could do was to take on the Enough Said campaign. the tragedy that over 11,000 rape kits were sitting in a warehouse in Detroit.
Unbelievable.
You know, and when Prosecutor Kim Worthy came to me, I said, we have to do something. We have to do something. She is the, you know, she's kind of our leader, the mentor for this whole United States on this issue. And she really taught us what needed to be done, and that was to help her raise money to get these rape kits tested.
That, you know, it seems like there would be something built into the budget anyway, the Wayne County's budget or whoever.
Oh, I'm sure it was.
To do that.
I'm sure it got spent on some other things.
Yes, but that meant, what did that tell you, though?
Exactly. What did it say about crimes against women?
Thank you.
They were not important. And we said, and that's kind of why we chose this enough said, kind of enough, stop sexual assault in Detroit, which is what enough said stands for. And so if we can get these rapists, if we can get the rape kits tested, we can get money for Kim's cold case unit to investigate these crimes. Let's put these criminals in jail. Let's get them off our streets.
People don't realize, too, how important it is. It's bad because here women have been raped or abused, and they don't want to report it, but they go on and report it, and nothing was done.
Some of those kits sat on a shelf for 30 years. So we really, really did our board did some real soul searching and said we have to take this on.
So what kind of things did you do?
We started raising money for Kim. You know, we don't want to be in the business. We aren't in the business of, we can't help Kim. She can do this herself. You know, Kim Worthy is a very able, well-respected prosecutor,
right.
And she has a passion for this. And we knew that if we could just get her the resources to test the kits.
Absolutely.
And to investigate, we went from we took on this cause, Kim had 2 investigators. Now she's got 17.
Oh,
so
that's fabulous.
So we're making a huge dent. We've got a long way to go. It's not over. We've got a couple more years of hard work to fundraise to make sure that this, and we're getting some great help from a group of women, the 490 Challenge, that group of African-American women.
Yes.
In this city have,
yes,
taken up.
Yes.
They are going to test the last of these rape kits for us, and we're almost there. There's all kinds of things that they're doing, from house parties to big concerts, as you just heard about. And so
Erica Badu,
she did a great job. If you were either
there. I've seen her before. She's excellent.
And she has a passion for this. And
yes,
she said we raised over $50,000 on that one night. So that's pretty exciting. And that will pay for an investigator to go out and investigate these crimes. Crimes that are 30 years old are hard to investigate.
Very, very. Well, you know, enough said. It can't be enough said about
exactly.
Enough said.
Exactly.
Right?
That's worth the whole show in itself.
But I
don't want to let those young women go.
One of the women who's in it, I believe Kim Trent.
Her
husband's on my next show right after this show.
Well, make sure he talks about that
a little bit.
Oh,
yeah, well.
Because that's a real passion of everybody.
Oh, yeah, well, I'm going to have Kim on to
Perfect.
Talk about it. I want to have her on to talk about it.
Perfect.
And, but I'm really... Well, you know, I taught for 39 years, high school, girls, guys, all of that, and had several initiatives that dealt with young people. And I am so impressed with what you're doing with Camp Moxie. Would you tell the audience about some of the programs you have for the young women?
The most important thing we can do is to raise this next generation of young women leaders so that they can actually complete the job that we started,
yes,
30 years ago. And so that's really...
You know, it's funny when you say that we started it so long ago. That tells you, that is crazy.
It is. I thought it'd be done.
Because you always thought that when I'm grown, I know this will be all done.
My children will never have
right.
to think about this. And we raised our daughters that
right,
way. I know.
Right.
And
I
we
know.
Raised our sons that way.
Right.
That women have equal opportunity. They're just, you know, we're all a part of the same
family.
Well,
my mother always said that, and she said it back then, and she's almost 97 now, and she'll say it now, a woman's pay was never commensurate to a man's.
And that's
still
true.
She raised me. She was saying that. She said, I do the same thing. My mother's a nurse, retired nurse. But I grew up saying that, not understanding why.
Right.
So I'm working as hard as anybody.
Absolutely. In fact, harder, because you're going home and making sure dinner's on the table and the house is cleaned up. And so anyway, we decided that was going to be one of our most important pillars, was to invest in these young girls.
Absolutely.
We started a program about 20 years ago for high school girls called Young Women for Change. Been a fabulous program. We actually have a Young Woman for Change on the east side of the state and on the west side of the state. One of these girls who have grown up now and are young millennial professionals leading these programs. Ariel Johnson here over in Southeast Michigan, and Ellie Drain over in West Michigan.
And Southeast Michigan, what does that encompass here?
It's everything. You know, that's these 7-8 counties that we go kind of as far as Ann Arbor. Everything kind of Lansing and over is on our West Michigan office.
Okay.
It's responsible there. So Young Women for Change is for high school girls. We have three chapters here in Southeast Michigan. We partner with organizations. We're partnering with Pretty Brown Girls.
I know her.
Great organization.
Right.
They help work with us. We have a young woman who's coming on in October who's gonna help her run these programs. And we have a program in Ann Arbor. We have a program in Southfield. So these are great programs.
Well,
Camp Moxie is the summer program for these girls.
I want to go back to
the
young women. How do women get an opportunity? Young women find out about this?
Well, they go online. A lot of times their mothers will do this. I get a lot of calls from mothers. MIWF.org, they can go to our website, MIWF.org, or they can give us a call.
The Michigan Women's
Foundation, 313-962-1920.
They have a remarkable website,
right,
too, everybody.
And so just go to those resources, give us a call, and we'll get your daughter involved in one of these.
What are some of the activities that they do?
These girls look at three or four different things through the year. First of all, we want them to understand what some of the problems are. We the program started out as kind of social justice program. Why are things unequal? Why are they different? What's wrong? What's systemically wrong here that, you know, maybe their teens are getting pregnant and shouldn't. Maybe the education system isn't what we want it to be. Maybe there's bullying in schools. They take on an issue.
Okay.
They look at it. They investigate it. Then they find an organization that's doing something about it. And then the Michigan Women's Foundation matches any money that they raise, and then we give it to that organization, and they stay involved. This year, we added two other things to those girls, to that programming. We added entrepreneurship. We helped them start thinking about what if they could start a business around that problem. What would they do? What would be a good business that where you could sell some services or some products that would help support this important initiative? Because we think that's really how problems get solved.
Right.
When people get passionate about them and when they
start to do something. And they have a vested interest.
That's right. So this program, and a few years back, we started a middle school girls program called the University of Life. And that middle school girls program is when we think the most important decisions in a young girl's life get made. You know, girls kind of head in one direction or another. You remember those days. And we know that we're losing a lot of girls in middle school.
These times are more trying than when you and I came up.
That's right.
We didn't have all distractions.
And so we started this middle school program. It's now just a summer program. It's 1 week at Oakland University. We take girls from all over the community. Last year we had 58 girls. Next year we have a challenge from Oakland University. They will help us support 100 girls.
Oh my goodness.
So we're going to be back to you asking you to help spread the word.
Well, I have a lot of young people. I have a lot of connections to a lot of young people. And so you have that. And then what about Camp Moxie?
Camp Moxie is a summer program for high school girls. And so girls spend a week at a camp. They spend a week at we've been doing it in conjunction with the Girl Scouts, where they spend a week at a camp. Next year we're going to look at possibly getting them on a college campus.
That would be
important for them. And so we're just
what
very
ages?
Excited.
What ages?
These girls are all either going into high school, going into ninth grade, whatever grade you're about 14, but they can be 14 to 18. The older girls act as mentors mentors to the younger girls.
Oh, that's great.
It's a wonderful program.
You know, peer mentoring is one of the best things that you could have.
Absolutely. You've got to see it to understand how you too could behave that way.
Right.
You too could make those kind of decisions. Right. And so that's what we teach these girls.
Oh, that would be wonderful. Just wonderful. And
women get involved, by the way. All your listeners out there who'd like to come out, we do what we call speed mentoring, where everybody gets a chance to meet somebody for 5 minutes and talk to them. And it's wonderful. We use our whole network statewide to help these girls. The idea is it's with the entrepreneur program and with the young girls program. Open up the world to them.
You know, that entrepreneur program is starting them young, learning about this.
Exactly.
That seems to be so fantastic because, you know, besides maybe having a Kool-Aid stand or a lemonade stand when you're a kid.
Right. Which is good.
Many of us were told, get a job, something substantial, something that can, you
exactly.
know. I wasn't encouraged to
be an entrepreneur.
Be an entrepreneur.
And now I think this young generation of young people are very interested in being entrepreneurs. But frankly, so is our cohort of women.
Yeah.
Our group of women.
We've
worked hard all our lives. Now we want to do something that we're passionate about, that we're really excited about.
A bunch of us have a business. I have one. Michelle, my producer who's over there, she has one. We all.
Right.
I mean, things we didn't think of doing.
That's right. And you can make money at it. And shows young people that they can do it, too, at any stage in life. So that the entrepreneur program is great. And we give microloans to women who need some resources that they couldn't get anywhere else. If they can get a bank loan, they should go to the bank. But this is for women. Our organization is for women who have been shut out of the system and might not be able to go to a bank and get a bank
loan. What about Unplugged?
Life Unplugged, that's a great program within our other programs that is teaches you about financial literacy. It is a game that they play.
That is fabulous.
It's a very important game it's a game because for children it still is a game. They don't have to most of them don't have to support themselves. But what it does is they roll the dice and they get a job, they get the number of children they're going to have, they get whether they're married or unmarried, and then they have to play out the game, and they all want to change. Some kids come to us and say, I'd like to turn in my children. Where can I turn in my children? So no, you can't
children
do that.
No joke.
You can't turn in your children.
But that's a reality check. That's a great reality check.
And they realize that they need to stay in school. But at the end of this game, they're telling you all the things that you've been telling them that they weren't listening to. I have to stay in school to be able to get a job.
Important.
Yeah, I have to go. I have to do the things that will keep me, I have to buy, you know, to keep me solvent, financially solvent. Oh, I spent too much on clothes, or I spent too much on a house, a car. I have to do things that I can afford given my salary. It's great.
You know, a lot of people grow up not understanding money.
That's right.
It takes a real understanding with money.
And so we instill that in both of these programs, especially our middle school girls. And they get it. They get it. They get it. To watch them go through that program and they come out the other side. It's a lot of fun. There's a lot of good stories about that.
So for people to sign up for the programs, they should go to your website and find out more about it.
MIWF.org.
Do you have some events coming up that...
We have an exciting event coming up for our entrepreneurs that I want you and your listeners to know a lot about.
Viewers. You on television.
That's
lady.
True. That's true. I try not to think about it because then I'm worrying, oh.
Oh, no, you're beautiful.
Oh, thank you.
Anyway.
So what's going on right now in our organization is that we've selected 10 finalists out of 160 applications for business plan and pitch competition, which we call Dolphin Tank. Instead of Shark Tank, I know a lot of your viewers watch Shark Tank. But this is Dolphin Tank. This is kinder, gentler, smarter, and more beautiful.
Of course.
For women. And so we've picked 10 finalists. They're getting coaching right now. And this fall, on November 9th, we're going to have a big Dolphin Tank where everybody can come, sit in the studio audience, and watch these dolphins give them advice and challenge them. And then we're going to invest in 3 of these women. So it'll be a lot of fun. Come vote. There's going to be an audience
and when
choice.
You say pitch a business
plan. Pitch their business plan. They're going to pitch. Wow. They're going to stand up in front of all of us, and they're going to give a 3-minute pitch. And then if they get selected to be in the final three, they're going to answer a 1-minute question that comes either from the audience or from the judges. And then the audience is going to vote, but then we have a panel of well-known people, judges, that are going to help make the selection.
Where will this take place?
At the Detroit Opera House.
Oh, right down the street.
Yeah, right downtown. Yeah, so very easy to get to.
Anyone come?
Anyone can come. It's free. We want everybody to get excited about our women entrepreneurs in the city of Detroit and in Southeast Michigan.
Wow, that is fantastic.
So I'll tell you more about
it.
So
will that be a yearly thing?
It is a yearly thing. This is the third year that we've done second year we've done Dolphin Tank, and actually the fifth year that we've done our business plan and pitch competition. So we've given over, we give away around $100,000 during this evening. It's worth coming.
Is there any place that women can get advice on business plans? And
absolutely.
All of this?
If you call our office, we will refer you to some of our wonderful partners, Lifeline Business Consulting, another person you should have on.
She is coming on.
We're her partner in this, in what we call the microloan collaborative, and she gets people ready to come to our program, and then when they're ready for a microloan because they've gone through her classes, We open our pocketbooks and resources that people have helped us raise. So we take this very seriously, and we really hold hands with these women and stick with them throughout.
It's like giving a leg up, just a leg up.
That's right.
And that's so important, because a lot of times people have great ideas. They don't know where to start. They don't know what is even entailed in having a business.
They don't.
And I've seen things in New York for the musical Hamilton.
Right.
This guy created a business called Line Sitters, where instead of standing in that line, you could hire a line sitter to stand there to get tickets.
That's great.
I mean, but it's a flourishing business.
But what a great business.
I mean, just an idea. See, a lot of people don't know how to bring their ideas into fruition. Then a lot of mistakes are made, too, when they try, I'm going to just start this business and don't know anything.
And we know that, and we understand it. And that's why we have great partners like Lifeline who get people started. Then we stick with them. And we've got 200 women mentors here in this area that will help them that have had successful businesses, that know what it means to start a business, understands cash flow, because a lot of women, if you had a job all your life you just check cashed every week or every other week, and what they have to understand is that you have to make sure that in good times you're saving some of that money so that you'll have enough cash flow. And so we teach all that, and we work with them. We have a program once they get there. We'll have one of our microloans they go through called Go for the Growth, where we teach them to go to the next level, to get higher and higher, grow their business bigger and bigger.
Foundation.
We're the next group of women millionaires.
You put the foundation in foundation. And once again, November 9th, what time?
It's in the evening, 5:30 to 8.
Okay, that's
come
great.
Come and we'll feed you. You have to buy a drink, but we'll give you, water and pop.
Everybody knows how Orchestra Hall works.
Yeah.
But anything else coming up?
Well, those are the most important things right now. And then we've got next spring, we have our big events, which I'll come back and talk to you about.
Our dinner and
our luncheon. Those are the big events that raise about half of the money that we're able to give away each year.
Oh,
so
I really
those
want
are important
to publicize
events.
That. I want to come to that.
I'll be back. Where you are now. You're in trouble.
Well, that's no problem with me. Anything to help women.
Thank you.
I'm all in there. And not only that, we need this. This is something we need to know, because there are so many women who do great things that don't know how to get to first base.
That's right. And we have to celebrate them, and we have to show others how they can do exactly what those women did.
Absolutely. So that's the Michigan Women's Foundation, everyone. You could just go online, put it in. And what's the shorter version?
MIWF.org.
MIWF. www.brendaperrymanshow.org. And there's so much information. In fact, you could spend half the day reading the information they have on there. So thank you, Carolyn.
Thank you. Good to see you.
You too. I will be back in just a moment with Dr. Bridget Leonard.
Livingston Family Dentistry knows that good dental care ensures overall wellness, and healthy teeth and gums can perfect your smile. With over 30 years of experience, Dr. Ronald and Dr. Blake Livingston take the time to explain every treatment. Their modern office and friendly staff are committed to making you feel comfortable, informed, and satisfied. Located at 13724 Woodward in Highland Park, call now, 313-883-3050. If your teeth are not becoming to you,
then you should be coming to us.
I am back. I am back with a woman who represents a profession that, well, is so necessary in this society and in this community. I have Dr. Bridget Leonard here. Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
I am great. I am blessed. Thank you for having me here.
So what made you decide at a young age to be a nurse?
Wow. I actually decided to be a nurse at about 25 years old.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I initially wanted to be a social worker. I went to LPN school at 25 and decided this is what I want to be. I had a couple of sick relatives in my life, and I saw the care that they received in the hospital, and I said, you know, I have that in me. I can do it too.
Wow. Well, let's talk a little about your background, and then we'll get into Black Nurses Rock.
Right.
Remember, everyone, Table Talk is on right after the show. We're going to be spinning some controversy this morning.
Wow.
And so you grew up here?
I grew up in Detroit. I was the east side of my whole life.
Where'd you go to high school?
I went to high school at Northern. Parents went to Northern also, yes.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Really, some great people I know went to Northern High School. And then what?
Well, you know, I started off kind of rocky. I'm blessed to be here at this point in my life because I started off as a teen mom at 15. I have six kids and eight grandkids.
You have
right
six?
Now. I have six kids and eight grandkids. So I started off as a teen mom. I actually dropped out of high school at one point because I felt that at 17 I had two kids. I felt, you know, what's the point of school? It really took me to get my husband in my life has been married for 25 years now. For him to get in my life to say, you know what, you have a lot in you. He saw things in me that I didn't see in myself.
Oh.
And there were times when he would sit in a car. We had one car that was kind of, you know how cars are.
Yes, I did.
He would drive me to school because it wasn't the best car, and he would actually sit in the car and wait for me to come out of classes. So I love this man. This is my best friend. I've been with him 25 years. But, you know, those were the types of things that make me want to help so many other people.
But the good thing was that you did not see having children young as the end of the road.
No, having kids young was a building block for me. It was a foundation. It was like, you know what, Bridget, you have to make a better world for your kids. You have to make a better world for everybody. And they were my inspiration. You know, looking into their faces, it made me get up and go. When I wanted to say, no, this is too much, or, oh, this test is coming up, it made me say, Bridget, push through it. You can get this done. And my kids are so proud of me today, and they strive for so much more because of the example that I've shown them.
I tell you, and your grandchildren will too, because as you raise your children, you're raising your grandchildren. You're setting that legacy up.
Yes.
You know, it's so important. So then you became an LPN, but then you decided.
Yeah, I actually went through every rank of a nurse. I became an LPN. I went to JTPA School of Nursing. Shout out to JTPA. JTPA was a job training partnership act program for LPNs. It was for low income women and men to go to nursing school. So that provided my foundation. I went into long-term care, became an RN. Actually had a director of nursing, again,
a lot of times people see things in you that you don't see in yourself. Mm-hmm. And she pushed me, and she paid for me to go to school for my associate's degree at Henry Ford. I went to school for my associate's degree. She put me in a management position. I've been in management ever since. Went back to school for my bachelor's degree. Went to University of Phoenix, received my master's in business and also my master's in nursing. And in December of 2014, I actually received my doctorate in nursing practice from Madonna University.
Congratulations, everybody. A pure example of what you can do when you set your mind to it. And so you've been mostly in administration, but have you ever worked the floor?
I worked the floor for 2 years. I've been in administration for about 18 years, but I love my role because I'm the type of person, I'm always mentoring people and empowering people.
Right.
So I'm constantly pushing. I'm not only pushing the nurses, I'm pushing the housekeepers, I'm pushing the people at the front desk. When are you going back to school? Oh, you're going to school? Let's do
right.
this.
Well, that's so important when people know somebody's paying attention to me. Somebody is paying attention.
Someone's listening.
Right. That is fabulous. So here you are with this doctorate of is it doctorate of what?
Doctorate of nursing practice. It's a DNP degree.
Gee.
I love
that
nursing.
That is great. You sure do. That is fabulous. Man, kind of blew my mind because back in the day, my mother was an LPN, and then they didn't have all that then. I mean, or they didn't let us know. Right. And sometimes you got to know, and right. then you grow.
That's true.
Oh, I'm a poet. No,
you are.
Anyway, let's kind of look at some of these. How was Black Nurses Rock founded?
Oh, my goodness.
And tell us about Black Nurses Rock. What is that about?
I get so excited thinking about Black Nurses Rock. So excited. Shout out, kudos to Dr. Ometrius Moss. She's the creator, the founder, the president of Black Nurses Rock. She developed Black Nurses Rock in 2014. It actually started on Facebook. She started a Facebook group, and it just blew up. Today, there's over 169,000 members on Facebook. So she took her vision to another level, and she said, you know what, the nurses in the online community are engaged, they want to get out and they want to make a difference, let's actually put it into the communities. So what she did was a call for chapters in various states. So her vision from 2014 to now has expanded to, there are 36 chapters that are official. There are so many other chapters that are still in the making. We are spread across the United States. We're in Florida, Indiana, Michigan, Texas, Virginia, California, New York. And these are chapters of nurses, student nurses, LPNs, RNs that are going out, that are revamping themselves professionally and personally, and also, most importantly, giving back to the communities that they serve.
So that's what I was going to get into, what the mission was.
Oh, yes. The mission of Black Nurses is to inspire and empower innovative leaders that will serve and educate vulnerable communities.
And Detroit is considered a vulnerable community,
of
course.
Oh, Detroit is definitely a vulnerable community, and we are hoping with our 139 members, we're actually the largest chapter of Black Nurses Rock.
Of course.
We received a reward for that on our recent cruise, so we're proud of that. But we are hoping to make a tremendous impact, not only in Detroit, but in Metro Detroit area, because
our
members are from all across the state.
Right.
Yes,
right,
definitely.
Because stressed communities, Highland Park, Pontiac.
Yes, Flint,
uh-huh.
and so forth.
Right,
yes.
Right, absolutely. So how can a community benefit? Well, I guess it would benefit from the things that, the initiatives that you all have?
Oh, yes. We have right now we have four focused initiatives. Cardiovascular health, really focusing on.
That is so important.
Hypertension and stroke. You know, those are the issues that are affecting our Black people, and especially our women. Yes.
In the last month, I know three men who've, you know, had cardiac casts, checked for blockages and all of those things, and then strokes. I know somebody I'm going to go visit next week who had a
milestone. And, you know, and whenever we think of heart attacks, we usually address men, but we have to understand
that women,
because we hold so much in, so much in, that stress gets to
us. Trying to be strong.
We're having those heart attacks and those strokes more than men, so we have to be aware of the symptoms for
more than men.
Yes.
Jeez.
Because we hold so much in.
Can we kind of review some of the symptoms of heart disease? Do you know some of that you could just tell my audience about some of the symptoms? When should you maybe go check out a doctor or the emergency room or something?
Okay. Like if you're having a stroke, if you're having a stroke, you will have some facial drooping. You may have one side that's weaker than
the... So not just age, like my face is dropped.
No.
You will have
like a lopsided smile. You will have one side, your arm, you may not be able to pick up your arm. You may have some slurred speech. You may start to fall over things. You know, you just have to, when things like that happen, please call for help, because if you're able to get into the emergency room within a reasonable amount of time, there are medications they can give you that can help slow down that process so you won't have as bad of effect as if you were just left at home alone.
Okay, so the cardiovascular,
yes.
What's another?
Oh, another one that's really important is HIV/AIDS and STDs. People are really, you know, back in the early 80s, in the mid 80s, HIV was everywhere. But now in 2016, you very rarely hear anything. Our teens are looking at people like Magic Johnson and thinking that they have their whole lives to live, and they don't understand the impact that it's having. But, you know, again, HIV/AIDS, and we also don't want to sleep on STDs, gonorrhea, chlamydia.
My cousin is a doctor for the Center for Disease Control, and the epidemic proportions among black youth, that's what a lot of times they don't realize. It's an epidemic proportions.
What looks good is not always good for you.
I know. All that glitters is not gold.
It is not.
In fact, it's the opposite of gold. It's coal. No, but anyway.
And also, focusing on diabetes. Actually, with the HIV/AIDS, I just want to bring up tonight at Old Crab Restaurant on Northwestern Highway, we're doing a fundraiser there.
Old Crab?
Yeah, Old Crab Restaurant is actually one of our Black Nurses Rock members.
Where is that?
I believe it's 32407 Northwestern Highway near Orchard Lake in Northwestern.
I'm seeing it.
It's a crab restaurant, variety of crab flavors. We're doing a fundraiser tonight. A portion of those proceeds will go to our HIV Detroit walk that we're having on September 25th. So variety of crab legs. Come out and join us. It's a fundraiser. We would love to have you there. So that's one of the initiatives we're doing. Another initiative that we're focusing on is diabetes. We have to reach
out. Epidemic proportions.
We have to reach out to diabetes. One of the things that we're doing for that, we're involved with the diabetic walk that's happening next weekend on September 18th.
Where is that?
At Comerica Park. So we're asking people to join our walk and help us to raise funds. We're joining that with Eat Clean, Train Dirty. Eat Clean, Train Dirty is one of our partners. One of the founders, Kevin Maples, he was actually a diabetic, and he found this organization.
He was a diabetic?
He is a diabetic, but it's controlled. It's controlled with food and exercise. So he found this program where basically you revamp your thinking to eat clean, train dirty, eat in a healthier lifestyle, and work out. In fact, tonight we're having boot camp tonight. I'm kind of excited, I think, about having boot camp tonight.
You think? Because you're going to exercise?
Yes, we're gonna box it out and work
That's
it out.
That's all I
But
do.
It's going to make the heart go. It's going to make me live a little longer. I can do this.
Gee, that is amazing. That's one of the hardest things to do is exercise. I can try and eat right. I could do all of this, but that exercise.
But the goal is to move. Even if you just walk, we just ask you, just move. Just get up out of your seat. Stop living a sedentary lifestyle.
Right,
just get up and move.
In my office, I do have a bike, a bike. I got to get all that stuff off the arms of the bike.
Yes, you have to take that off.
It's not the first time in my life I've had a bike. Before it was a hanger. I even put it in my bedroom before, and we used it as a hanger. This one, I'm going to use it. I was looking at it yesterday. I said, get those purses off that those handlebars.
Get them off. And our last initiative is youth-focused initiatives. We really understand the youth in Metro Detroit, they need an outlet. They need to get away from the computers. They need to get outside. But when they're outside, they need to feel safe. They need to be in an environment.
Absolutely.
They need to go somewhere so they can do things. So we're looking at some youth-focused initiatives so that we can give the kids a platform so that they can grow and live healthy lifestyles, because they are our future, and we have to prepare them for that.
So youth-focused initiatives. Have you all been thinking of anything?
We have been thinking, like, we've even thought about, like, a junior Black Nurses Rock, like students that may be interested in going into nursing.
Well, in high school,
yep,
future nurses of America.
Them young. And we also have partners in the community that we're looking at that will help us to help with some of these initiatives. We have an advisory panel. On our advisory panel, we have a physician. We have someone that's involved with marketing. We have a City of Detroit staff member. We have a Detroit Public School rep. We have a Detroit Public School principal. We have a Detroit Police Department rep. We have university nursing faculty, a pastor of a large church, and we have a wellness coach. So we understand that we can't do this alone.
It takes
a village to raise these kids. And so we have an advisory board that we're reaching out to, saying, okay, how can you best use us as nurses to reach out and help these kids? So we're looking at things that we can do for our kids.
Gosh, I mean, nurses. How are more people coming to nursing now, or less people? You know how occupations, sometimes
they kind of shift. You know, it kind of goes up and down. You know, there are a lot of people that have interest in nursing, but unfortunately, the universities and the various schools really don't have enough faculty and enough clinical sites to train all the nurses. So that's a roadblock that's a barrier for us, because we have a lot of interest, but just having that faculty. So nurses out there, if you're working full-time, even if you just go into an adjunct faculty role, that would be great, so that our students can have a teacher so that they can be our future nurses.
Right, absolutely. Because in my opinion, we were talking about this, or I was talking about it when we were coming into the studio, was the fact that they just work nurses. Nurses are the backbones of hospitals.
Yes, nurses are the veins and the arteries of the hospitals. We are there 24/7. When the physicians go home, when the therapists go home, you have the nurses there holding it down, making sure that patient is our priority.
And the fact, it takes a special kind of person, really, to work with sick people.
Oh, yes. You take a lot. I always tell people, you can't go into nursing looking for a pat on the back. Sometimes you may have to be the one to pat yourself on the back. But to just see the help that you're able to give someone, there's really no value you can place on it. And it's just such a great feeling. Again, no value can be placed on it. That's why I don't mind, when I get off of work, being really involved with Black Nurses Rock, continuing on that journey to give all that I can, because I just feel it just flows out of me. I just love nursing. I'm in love with nursing.
Well, it's so important, because the doctors, they come in, they do their little 2-minute visit with each patient. They leave some notes and everything.
Right.
They know that they have the nurses to fall back on.
Yeah. Yeah, and we have their back. We have their back. We have their front. Because that patient is ours. That patient becomes like an extended member of our family.
I know. Gosh. I don't know how people do it. I think I was in future teachers, because I just knew I wasn't going to be in future nurses. Because it does. But, you know, I went into a noble profession. But I think that the nurses, I mean, look at what's at stake with their patients. You know, they can make that difference.
Yes, and that's why, you know, as nurses, we're continually growing. We're continually going back to school. We're taking certification classes. We're taking classes where we can learn various things. We're constantly growing. I always tell people, a day without learning something new is a day wasted. So I always tell people, strive to learn something, one thing, at least one thing new every day.
You are such a great example to people. You're so motivating. You are so motivating. Do you speak? Do you go around and speak ever to groups?
Oh, yes. I have a passion for teen moms. I have a passion for teen moms. You know, letting them know that, you know, your child, I want you to look in the eyes of your child and know that the world is at your fingertips. Nobody can want more for you than you want for yourself. Strive for the stars, and maybe you can land on the moon.
That's what they said in that movie, Betty Davis movie. Yes. Let's not hope for the stars,
yeah,
Jerry. But it's so important, and I think that I'm worried about the schools, because I know there are people, and then you have to be accepted too.
Yes.
Because my neighbor, young lady, my daughter's friend, well, a very bright young lady, but she said they were, you know, she had to take the test in order to go further,
yes,
with pass the LPN and so forth.
Yes. The entrance, yeah, there are various entrance exams. And so that's one of the things that, again, I'm glad that we have so many nurses on board. Like I said, we have 139 members, and they come across so many different specialties. We do have a lot of teachers that are nurses in our organization that are passionate about helping future nurses get ready for these exams, whether it's an entrance exam or whether it's actually the NCLEX exam where you actually test to get your actual license. So we are committed
to getting
that.
What are the skills, the educational subject matter that you should be strong in?
Oh, you definitely have to be strong in your science and your math. Definitely strong in your sciences and your math, because you're going to learn every organ of the body, and in your math you have to be on point to make sure that you can get those dosage calculations right for medications.
Oh, dosage, that's very important.
Very, very important.
Very important.
Yes.
Golly, I remember when my son had chicken pox, and my ex-husband figured the more medicine you gave him, the less he'd itch. My son was out. So you got to know how to give those dosages.
Yes.
Okay. So any events coming up besides tonight? Okay, tonight, let's review, because I may go to the crab place tonight.
Tonight at Old Crab on Northwestern Highway near Orchard Lake, we are having a fundraiser for AIDS Walk Detroit.
Who owns that?
That is Shelly Peak. She's actually a Black Nurses Rock member also.
Support a sister.
Yes, she's a sister nurse with the Old Crab restaurant, and it is great food.
They have crab legs and stuff?
Crab legs, lobster tails, shrimp.
Got to find this place tonight.
Come tonight. Yes, come
tonight. Tonight. Okay.
Yes, and then we have the Diabetic Walk next Saturday at Comerica Park. We have AIDS Walk Detroit September 25th.
How does one sign up for the Diabetic Rock? Walk.
I'm sorry. Go to Step Out Walk. I'm sorry.
Have a website?
We do not have a website, but if you go to Step Out Walk Diabetic Walk, you can look for Black Nurses Rock and sign up under our team.
But you are on Facebook.
Yes, we are on Facebook, yes.
Excellent, excellent, excellent. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you for having us. We, like I said, Black Nurses Rock, Detroit chapter, we are here, and we are here to stay, and we are ready to make a difference.
Oh, this is great. Black Nurses Rock, look them up, and we'll get that website going, too.
Oh, yes, definitely get the website going.
So, everyone, stay tuned. We have Table Talk in just a few minutes, and we'll be back. I have Darnell and Ken with me once again. So we could fuss. You could fuss at Ken.